the network.
Bow. What's up, everybody? Once again, it's Brand Man Sean, and I'm back with another link up. Today, I am linking up with Teacup. You have seen her before. She is the voice of the indie artist, and as always, she is here recording live from the streets. So today, we got seven tips from Teacup, right? Teacup, seven tips for operating an event without a hitch. And I think this is super important because people talk so much about how do you get people out, but sometimes people get people to show up and the thing is trash and nobody's coming back. So Teacup, I'm glad you had this idea. You've been obviously doing it successfully for a good minute. One of the most well-known figures in the city, especially in the indie scene. So like, talk to me. I'm excited to kind of get your perspective on these things.
Okay, man, thank you for having me back. I really do appreciate all the love that I've been getting from your community. Like, a lot of people, they follow me and they ask me a lot of questions. I'm very responsive in like the DMs and emails. So thank you for having me back. And thank you to everyone that's watching, that's been engaging with me. So a little bit about what Sean said. I deal with artist development here in Atlanta. So pretty much if anybody wants to get connected to other people, to curators, they want to get on shows, they want to get interviews, they want promotions just to have their music disclosed, pretty much they hit me up and I help curate and plan events with them as well. So pretty much I just want to speak on artists throwing their events. So that's a very common question that I get a lot. And artists are pretty much, a lot of artists are just in different stages of event planning or throwing their own events. So some artists, it's their first time throwing an event and they don't know where to start at all. And then you have some artists that's been throwing events for a while, but they just want to grow like that audience, or they want to take it to the next level that includes like sponsorship or investment. So, yep, just wanted to say that clear. You know, it may be different orders or different steps or different people. Some people may not need all seven steps. Some people may just be two. Some people may just be starting in different areas.
That's real.
So always, 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 first before you do anything, you always want to research, okay? So you always want to do your research on the venues. You want to do your research on the area. You just want to understand just how people move, what would make people come to an event. So a lot of people, typically in Atlanta, when you say free liquor or free food, hello. Yeah. Okay. So you just want to research, just going outside and doing field research.
What does that look like though to you? Like what kind of information are you really taking in when you say research?
Okay, so yeah, so when I say research, I say finding out different pricing. Okay, so finding out good locations for people. Where do people like to go? What's more convenient for people? What are some things that people like to do when going out? Because everybody's an artist. Everybody goes to artists, to listening parties, concert shows, events, just every day of the week. So definitely find out how people move. Find out what people hang together. And I always tell people before throwing any events, go and make friends, you know, go and build those real supporters. Because when you throw your event, you want to make sure that you do have people that can support. I know a lot of artists, when they throw their events, you know, they do add other artists onto the bill with them. So if it's like a listening party, they may have featured different artists, or even if it's a concert, of course you're not throwing a concert alone, you know, while you're still growing your fan base. So definitely go out and make genuine friends with other artists. Build relationships with other artists. You can do this through social media. You can do this by going out and supporting them.
How important is like staying in the scene to you? Like actually physically going out to events?
I think that's very important because it's always like Atlanta supports Atlanta. It's always a support and support type thing. Like if, you know, you can't really, unless you have that sort of status or that sort of following where you can be more exclusive, when you're more on like that newer, more fresher wave, like the goal is to network. The goal is to go out and support people, not even just in a transactional way, but going in, seeing if you kick it with people at the studio, you know, going and seeing if you can kick it with people at a bar where it's not even, you're not even there for an event, you know? So I would say just physically going out, always. First, you always want to make friends. So that was two so far. Okay.
One, research. Two, field research. Friends. Make friends. Okay. That. Yep.
Three, think of the concept. So how people are kind of moving these days, I know like back in the day, you can get like some sort of hole in the wall venue. And as long as it's just like a lot of people there and, you know, it's just fun. But now in these days, people like activation, people like experience, people like to come and do shit. You know, people like I said, everybody's an artist. So you have so much competition against everyone. You have to compete probably against gonna throw in a concert on the same day of your event. You have to compete again. This going on, you know, it's so many things that go on in Atlanta. So you have to really conceptualize. You have to really stand out. You have to really do something that draws people to come out. So that pretty much bring me to like marketing.
Well, hold on. While you're still on concept, what have been some of the most interesting and dope concepts that you've like seen or been a part of?
Okay.
So we can kind of understand, like, when you talk about stand out and not just being like a basic event.
Okay. I would say with my homegirl, so she throws a party. It's called Bounce That. And it's an all-female party. The flyer is really adorable. She has incentives to make people want to come because it's a woman-based party. So she has things to make people come, like you get your nails done for free. It's free before a certain time. She has like a baby hair station, you know, all type of stuff. And it's basically catered towards women. So as it grew, she had like activations. Like she had a Barbie doll. It was like a Barbie doll frame that people could take photos in and stuff like that. So she has certain things exclusive to only her event that draws women to come out. That makes people like you only get this experience here at her event.
All right, so we're gonna talk about her a little bit for marketing too, because that's DJ also, right?
Yep.
Yeah, and her, I didn't know if she went into that level of detail in the actual event, but I rock with her marketing. Obviously, it's not for a male, so I never went, right? But so that's dope. Like the fact that. What'd you say?
You gotta be escorted by a woman to come.
Oh man, that's cap. So with that being said though, yeah, those smaller details and memorable experiences and getting to things that aren't even typically associated with a concert or like getting your nails done and things like that, to me that's what real experience and standing out really means in today's age, because you really are talking about, you're giving people the actual game, but I think some of it might go over people's head, right? So one, that's just a real thing. You got to make that happen. But two, when you talk about make friends, not only the friends you have, but make other friends in the environment, that's a real thing. But that doesn't get capitalized on as much until you get to step three. If you don't have a concept that like for real makes people talk about it, it's like, all right, they came out in support and, you know, that's it. Like, they're not going to talk about it. They're not going, it's almost going to be like, you know, I just did it off the strength, but I'm not going to play his record in the car, you know, because like I'm playing it one time because that's my homie, but I ain't playing this because I don't like it. It's the same for the actual event. Like, I came because I had something to do. But next time, since I know it's trash, I might, look, I already went once. I don't need to go again. You know what I mean? Like, that's for real. The mentality, you know how it is moving in and about the scene, but if it's something that's super dope, people will tell other people about it. Some people will try to steal it. But people will like make sure other people know about it. And that word of mouth is from the concept part. If you execute the market, I mean the research and then the frame part, like once you have that, if you come with a strong concept and execute on that, like it builds so heavy.
So glad you touched on the fact that word of mouth, that's like the biggest, that's the biggest ever form of promotion. That's the best form of promotion because, you know, if you have one person want to pull up, you know, rarely do people ever pull up alone. They always pull up. Usually they pull up with friends. So even when it goes to you making friends, don't neglect, you know, your girlfriend, your boyfriend, who probably got a couple friends, you know. Reach out to your cousin. I always tell people when throwing an event, I always say at least invite like 10 to 15 people who you know will pull up. You know, they're very close to you. They'll be there. Mm-hmm. invite them for free if you can, you know, just so you can have some sort of people there supporting you before everyone else. A lot of people, I know they may want to make that monetary gain, but when it's like your first event, I always just say, you know, just invite a couple of close ones just to share this experience with you, so they can be there early, send them a special invite. A lot of people do like the personalized flyers. You remember when J. Cole had the Dreamville flyers going around floating the internet? So I would say like send a personal invite to a few of the ones that you really want to come, like, you know, like a best friend, like a your brother, you know, some people that you will want there to share these moments that are also in return going to pass it by that word of mouth. So that goes into I'll say in the make friends number two. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then yes, marketing. So as me and Brandman Sean said, you always want to conceptualize on something that is going to capture the eye, using certain colors. Canva is great for making flyers. A lot of people do use those apps and things that can be on the phone, but definitely make sure your visuals look clean. You always want to make sure it's clean. Make sure you have the address on there if it is a public event. Make sure you have the date. It's the little things that can cause people to not go to your event. Because somebody will find a flyer and it's like, okay, but it has no address. It has no time on it. So what? Yeah. So it has no date. Like, did this pass already? Like, definitely important things to put on the flyer. I say for like, the average time to promote an event for a newer person may be like, I would say maybe 3 to 4 weeks. What do you think? What do you think, Sean?
Yeah. No, I would say 3 to 4 weeks in this age. If you're trying to do like 100 people, it's probably about 3 to 4 weeks. If you're trying to really push and make it something bigger, and especially get deeper into selling the experience, then it might need to be something bigger than that. Like, but most people need to start off with those 3 to 4 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And rely back on that word of mouth part. Like, that's like, you have to make people. I want to say this real quick, because like, the way I found DJ Oso was her flyer, because we're talking about marketing, right? Yeah. She had that flyer where it was like the girls in the car and it said bounce that, and they were I was like, yo, this ad is hard as
fuck. Yes,
I was like, who? I commented on because it was one of like this other chick I know. I was like, yo, who did this shit? And she was like, her. And I was like, ah, oh, man, yeah, I gotta follow her, because this junk is just hard. So that alone, like, people pay attention to the quality and your creative approach and your marketing, and then you bring that same energy to the actual experience. But learning that she's a DJ too, though, I feel like she has an advantage, because you're talking to a lot of artists. The part where a lot of artists mess up, this is where I had the advantage too when it came to like throwing events over a lot of my artist friends, because artists always try to make the shit about them versus just creating an experience where everybody else has a great time, not realizing that you can make them have a great time. They're going to just keep coming back to you off of that strength. They're going to want to be around you. But artists like, oh no, I just want everything centered around me and the stage, and they focus too much on that side of it.
Yeah, man, I'm gonna
exactly. Like that, for real. Like, especially if you aren't even strong in the show game. So make it about the fan. How can you make them have an amazing experience, regardless of you being there? And then how do you integrate your goals and your project or your narrative into a dope experience?
Yes. Thank you for breaking that down. Like, I always say with the marketing, when it comes to an event, especially for a newer artist, you want to treat your marketing with that 3 to 4 week span, you want to treat it like a project rollout. Like, think of it as you're rolling out a single, you're rolling out your EP, you're rolling out an album, a mixtape. So pretty much you have, you know, you announce it, and then every week is something else added on, and something else being added on, and something else being added on. Like, some people, okay, so the first week it may be a giveaway being done, you know, so we can get some more followers, so we can get more people looking or paying attention to the event. Next, you may announce like the special guest or the lineup, you know, and stuff like that. Then the following week of, you know, you may offer a giveaway, you know, for some merch or something like that, you know, for people that purchase the ticket as it gets nearer and nearer. Because a lot of people really purchase tickets as it gets closer to the event. Like I've noticed from me doing events, because it might scare you, you know, when you first announce it. People realize, okay, what's the move when it's like a day or two before the event, and that's when ticket sales will shoot up like that. Mm-hmm. So that's just my experience. And then even if you want to do something like, you know, giving a discount, rolling out a discount code on certain things, so you kind of have to build up that anticipation really for people to buy and for people to say, hey, I gotta be there. So to DJ Oso's case, I remember, you know, before she's dropped the flyer, she's dropped her promo video, she's announced like some special guests, you know, coming through and stuff like that. So it just builds on top of that anticipation, like, all right, boom, like I gotta be there. And then whatever you do, as far as like your different announcements and your different rollout, make sure it all has the same colors, like the colors that you use in your flyer or your branding, make sure they all have the same colors, make sure they all have the same aesthetic, make sure they all give out the same vibe. So that's pretty much just a couple of things to pay attention with the marketing. So.
Okay.
And then that goes back to, you know, using a graphic designer, things like that. And then I would say, of course, how do you pay for it? A lot of us ain't got no money, so how is we gonna pay for all of this? So, okay, this just starts off to say it's different. It just all depends on where you are. So some of you all may be just out starting. So it may be, of course, self-funded, which is typically ideal for the first event curator. A lot of people, they sell business slides. They may have a grab bag or something where people can sell items. You can pay a fee to give away your items in a gift bag, vendor slots, even sponsorship spots, whether it's a big or a small sponsorship. A lot of people will pay for, you know, just to have their logo on your flyer, just to have their logo on a step and repeat. So you can sell that even to smaller brands, like local brands, smaller brands, your homie that has a clothing line, stuff like that. And you can even package it for bigger brands, which Portia Marie gets more into that, of how to pitch to like a sponsorship, pretty much getting your pitch deck, having those things already ready, and then making face-to-face interactions with the sponsor reps that you want to meet. So I'll let her video explain that. I know she did talk about how she met Google and made that relationship. She already had her pitch deck and everything ready top of the year, and then she knew that Google was having an event and she wanted to talk to a specific person, so that's when she made the connection.
So she has a lot of events. Well, make sure, send me the specific ones, like the videos that you're talking about, and we can put those in the link in the description for anybody interested in checking her stuff out and understanding how to get that sponsor game together.
Yep. And then even if it's not from brands, a lot of times we overlook a lot of people that are around us that want to invest in us. Like a lot of people think we have to get an investor, like an actual investor, which that's cool too. But in a lot of cases, a lot of people around you are willing to invest in you. A lot of people that believe in you are willing to invest in you. I've even had like my therapist, you know, she's seen me on Instagram and offered to, you know, want to invest just in return me advertising her brand. So it's just all about different conversations, all about different relationships that you make with people and people that most importantly believe in you. So.
Interesting. Have you ever like heavily needed to get investment for one of your events?
Definitely. A lot of my events coming up, hopefully after this virus passed by, I'm going to get some, definitely going to get some investments. Hopefully, let's keep our fingers crossed. For the most part, for my events, I do use vendors and I do use sponsors, like people that want to just pay to put their logos on things. So That's really been starting out for like my events so far. So
which one do you think is easier? Like for
vending,
someone who
course,
just really don't get it.
Vending is always going to be easier. You have people that always want to sell, that sell so many things, that sell art, that sell clothes, right around you, even charging like, you know, $50, you know, stuff like that where they can come and do a setup. If you get so many people, then that's going to probably pay for like your DJ, you know, pay for certain places. And then I just want to talk about just the places that we, that people tend to have events too. A lot of these are built off of relationships, because I used to have Artisan Bar and Gallery, you know, for free at no cost in the beginning to really build my following, or, you know, a lot of the artists that were on my shows. And then a lot of people just think, you know, you gotta have like some fancy place. Like a lot of people, I've seen people have events in Airbnbs. I've seen people have events in like restaurants, you know, where a restaurant where it's a bar and they have just an area with the stage, you know, go and talk to people and say like, hey, you know, I'm looking to bring business to your facility. I have a crowd of people that like to drink, that like to eat. I think this will be a really good vibe with what I'm trying to do. If you just go talk to people, a lot of times, especially as a smaller artist, like it's no point for you to go and rent a masquerade. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like it's no point for you to try to reach out to Al Five when you're not bringing, you know, no more than 50 people. You know what I'm saying? So in a lot of places, I've literally seen so many, like I've been to an event by a lake before. Like all type of stuff where people just really get creative, you know? So, just as long as that sound right.
Now that's a big tip. That's a big tip. Cause it also, like, you don't have to even, it doesn't have to feel like, oh, I can't hit a certain number, right? When you have it in different environments, it just feels like a whole different aesthetic, a whole different type of like vibe where people aren't necessarily even expecting that show feel, hey, you got to bring out numbers. It just feels like you did something creative and different.
Hey man, when you having fun, if you're having fun, you're there with the right people, it won't even care how many people. You know what I'm saying? And then another thing, the most important thing I want to get, just let artists know about, is just like your ticketing, or just how to more so get in touch or keep in touch with the people that come. So definitely a great way to do would be, of course, Eventbrite, which is pretty much a app that everyone uses no matter what city they go to. Typical travelers, especially in Atlanta where people are always coming here, people tend to just get on Eventbrite and find events or find things to do.
And look for something to do.
The Splash is another ticketing app where you kind of can design the feel of your ticket. So basically, it's like you can create like a mini website for the event.
Which one would you go with and why? Because I've always wondered like why people choose to go with Splash That versus Eventbrite and vice versa.
I've actually personally never used Splash because of how I hear that they do the payout. I hear the payout is different. But I think Splash is very dope to give an aesthetic or to give a direct feel of your event, because it does give you like a temporary website feel where you can put GIFs and you can put customized photos and you can customize your layout so that people can directly see, you know, or understand a breakdown or just the overall feel. It goes into that marketing of like what they're going to. And you can see it just directly before purchasing. And that's the best thing to make people want to buy. I use Eventbrite because I love that Eventbrite has an email blast included with it. So with people that sign up for your past events, you can be able to invite them to future events. They can get an invite to their email. You can be able to get a reminder. You can be able to email them updates. Like if you say, hey, if you plan to come park here, don't forget to bring XYZ or wear a dress, or, you know, you can, it's more convenient for me. I haven't really tried Splash. Okay. Another app that people are using are the Dice app, which I'm seeing you can connect your phone number to it. And it has something to do with like your playlist. So it can pretty much like see what type of like, I believe you can like share music and things like that. And you can pay directly through like, cause you can send a ticket directly through your phone and you can pay through like Apple Pay and stuff. So I'm really still looking through the Dice app.
Okay. Yeah, I haven't heard of that one.
People are using that. I know DJ also uses that for her bounce at parties.
Okay.
So, yep. And then some people take cash, which that's fine too. The point that I'm just trying to say about keeping track of who all comes is that there need to be some sort of email list. of everybody that comes, so you can say thank you afterwards, so you can stay updated with them. So take that email list and export it, upload it to MailChimp. What is it called? Mad Mimi, one of those email blasts. Server, so that you can have a newsletter, and then you can stay just in contact with people that came to these events, and they can stay in contact with you. A lot of people are even taking it a step further and getting a text blast. So I've used like Hobnob, so that directly I can text people when I have events. So that's helped a lot, because I'll text them like a day before just to remind them. And even the Ryan Leslie video that you have on here, and where he also talked about, you know, the super phone. So a lot of artists are starting to get into that, so they can directly text their fan base or their following and let them know everything that they have coming up. Okay. So last one, recap videos. That's the most important. Like, people forget to get these so much because we don't know unless we see it. Dang, we missed out on a dope event. How we know? We don't see it. Okay, so you get this event, and your next one, you want to get those investors, get those new vendors or sponsors or whoever a part. Okay, so what are they going to have to go off that you've had a successful event and that you can bring out numbers? So recaps are always important, because content is just king nowadays, especially for IGTV. IGTV is now going to start monetizing like how YouTube is and charging for like ads.
I knew that was coming. It's about to be a lot of content that get hit down too.
Yep. Those are my steps for the artists looking to have their shows.
All right. So one thing I'll say about that recap video thing is like, that's it's so serious. When I first really started doing events that I was taking seriously, like the first event, it was, I didn't have nothing. Like, you couldn't have told nobody it happened. It never happened, basically. Like, we had no way to advertise it. I was like, this is crazy. And like, I was like, all these people, like, hit up your homies. Nobody really has anything. So then the second time, I was like, I'm gonna invite a whole lot of photographers, videographers, all that stuff. And we did have stuff, right? And I had to say, I had this one dude, I hired him to make a video, and we had a lot more, right? We had way more than zero. But the issue then was that it still didn't fully communicate what my event was trying to communicate, right? That incomplete energy. So one, make sure you do get a recap, but go further than just saying, hey, you want photos, and hey, I want a recap. Because the third time, I got super specific. I know the path of my event. I know when certain rooms are going to open up. I know what certain environments we're going to be like. So the third time, I'm like, all right, bruh, at this time, I need you to be here. I'm giving them a vision of what I really want the recap to look and feel like, making them understand the energy of the event. And then that time, it was like it was a true itinerary, almost like directing a film before it happened, putting that level of energy into it. Mm-hmm. Because the outcome was so much better, and you can get the energy of how different the event was from the video. Like, so it goes for me, like my path was like literally nothing. Okay, bro, how am I going to even advertise this already happened already? Then to something. But it just felt like any other regular old event. Like, it didn't feel different until the third time, where I got super specific, and finally the videographers got it right. So, don't just do the recap. Get specific about your vision that you're putting off, so it's communicated on the back end. But appreciate you, T-Cup. Can you go over those seven? Just a quick summary. Again, like, just say where they were, 1 through 7.
Okay, got you. So basically, first is to research, okay? Get some friends, get some close ones, okay? Always invite those people out first. Concept, so think, sit on a concept, get some inspiration, read some books, go out and experience life, think of the concept, okay? Definitely paying for it, that was one. The marketing, that was another one. Tickets, that was one, and then recap.
I was That was four.
That was recap. Four.
Hold up. So, wait, one. You said that was one like two, three times. I lost track.
Oh, I'm saying that was one, like that was another one. I'm sorry. Okay, so research, friends, concept, paying for it, marketing, ticket sales, and visuals.
Bet. All right. Bet. Appreciate you. That was dope. Yes, everybody, is another link up. Again, we have Teacup. Make sure y'all follow her. You know, go get game from her. You know, pay her. If you got something you could pay her for, hit her up for a consultation or something like that. And appreciate you once again. If you like this video, go ahead the like button. If you like it, you might as well share it. And if you're not subscribed, you know what to do. Hit that subscribe button.
It's the network. We'll be right back.